And I have interest in it, obvious interest in this in going on. Now, institutional investors are often attacked as passive, lenient, lax on corporate governance issues. However, the regulators, lawmakers, they trust them, they count on the institutional investors to protect the public, to protect the small investors. On one hand, they are inactive. On the other hand, everybody counts on them. So, is this realistic belief or a wishful belief of naive, perhaps more cynically lazy regulators? And do institutional investors play a positive role in defending small investors? Now we take a specific deal, an extreme environment, and we find some evidence that they do play a positive role in defending small investors. So we say yes, sometimes they do. And the deal we talk about are freeze-out tender offers. What are freeze-out tender offers? It's a deal where the control group offers to buy all public shares, take the firm private, okay? And this is a legitimate deal, okay? There are many legitimate reasons for such a deal. For example, perhaps the control group wants to achieve some synergies with other private company it possesses. Maybe those are typically, our sample is typically small firms. They want to save some regulatory costs. We all know that this regulatory burden is sometimes crushing. Maybe they want to keep information confidential. They don't want to disclose it to the public. Maybe they have some idea, personal vision that they cannot implement with all those public shareholders. Maybe they just want to simplify corporate structure or simply see no value in remaining a public company because they are typically small companies, thinly traded, and perhaps it was a mistake listing. Okay? However, there might be some deficient motivation for buying all public shares. Okay, perhaps it's a good timing for buying all public shares, and they want to buy public shares below true value based on their inside information. This is what we usually call in our field equity tunneling via some changes in equity possessions. Okay, that is based on asymmetric inside information. So there is also a suspicion that this legitimate deal might consciously or subconsciously be motivated by, let's say, wrong reasons. Now, institutional investors can do something, okay? Why they can do something in favor of the small public investors? Because they are more informed, they are better informed, they can help diminish information asymmetry, they can do some monitoring, say, voice, okay. They tend to suffer less from behavioral bias, meaning we have here among public investors, we have somebody that is more professional and more capable of, say, opposing misconceived ideas of controlling shareholders. And since we deal with a big deal, okay, it's taking the firm private by controlling shareholders, we looked and found in the literature that in big deals, institutional investors do make a difference, okay? Do make a difference. For example, Gasper, Massa, and Matos find that target firms held by institutional investors extract on average a 3% higher premium. So you get a 3% higher premium in M&A deals if you have institutional investors there, okay? They perhaps negotiate, perhaps behind the scene, perhaps they have other measures, but you, the end result, you get a higher premium, okay? And then there's another paper also that shows that it has to be concentrated holdings by independent long-term institution, meaning by somebody that has a large holding and cares. And if you have something like that, then post-merger performance is higher. So institutional investors do have an impact on significant firm deals, that's previous evidence. And we think we'll detect such evidence also in our deal, which is a little bit more shady. That's controlling shareholders want to take their firm private to buy them from the public. Now, our contribution is that we look at previously unexplored deal in this context of what is the effect of an institutional investor. We think we'll find the effect, a positive effect. We have previously unexplored data. Let me expand a little bit on that. We collect data from Israel, okay, where the regulation of resort offers is extremely lax. To make a freeze-out offer, you have to issue a 2-3-page document, and you don't have to disclose anything, or almost nothing. You don't have to have board approval. You don't have to have a special committee. You don't have to have a fairness opinion, nothing. You can wake up in the morning and make a freeze-out offer, tender offer. And we think we also have interesting, and we don't know if it's unexplored or explored hypothesis, so I put it in a question mark. We think that institutional investors act strategically, and I'll expand on that later on. Now here's the expansion. The three competing hypotheses, not so much competing, but let's see. The null hypothesis says it's institutional investors. That's the null hypothesis. Has no impact whatsoever on the outcome. It's nothing, okay? And we think we can reject it based on previous evidence, on M&As and so on. We think it, we can reject it, okay? But it's still good to see that we can reject it. Okay, that's a kind of a confirmatory check. Okay, then we have two other hypotheses. The first hypothesis is that institutional investor provide unbiased rational response to each freeze-out offer. They examine each offer separately and decide is it beneficial or not worthwhile and so on. Okay? And if they do that, they probably filter it out, and accepted offers have higher premia relative to firms where there are no institutional investors at all. And we have about a third of our sample are firms where there are no institutional holdings. So perhaps they filter out the offers and get only offers with decent and high premia. Perhaps they also, because they filter out the offers, they kind of reject a bad offer or exploitive offers, so there will be a higher frequency of offer rejection when institutional investors are there. And our third kind of implication, although we write it in hypothesis C, is when they reject the offer, the offer is not worthwhile, so stock prices will not retreat. Not retreat, will embed the premium. If they reject it, the offer, it means that they think the firm is valued more than the offer. So after the offer, after the rejection of the offer, price will not plunge back. It will stay high. Okay? Will stay high and perhaps go up even more, because if they are rational and if they are good evaluators, the firm is worth more. So it should not plunge and even continue to climb. So that's interesting to examine with the return data. The second alternative hypothesis, which is called hypothesis 3, is that they provide a strategic response to freeze out offers. And what do I mean by strategic response? You have to examine freeze out offers as part of a general picture of struggles, continuous struggles, everyday struggles between, say, institutional investors, outside investors, and controlling shareholders. Okay? It's a power struggle. Okay? And in this power struggle, institutional investor wants to gain some respect, want to gain some face, or want to gain some stance. Okay? So what they do is they say no. You need me? I also have some power. I can say no. Okay? In Hebrew we call it dafka. In your face, okay. So what that means is that still they would accept offer, but only generous offer, okay? And also there will be higher rate of higher frequency of offer rejection when there are institutional investors involved. And the third implication, which is different from the rational behaviors or concrete examination of every deal, the strategic share says that I'm willing to sacrifice a little bit here for the overall gain, okay? For my overall interest, and that means that they can reject even fair offers, maybe even slightly beneficial offers. The premium has to be real nice for me to overcome my resentment over you or my wish to show my power once confronting you. Okay. So this means that after a rejection, a stock price may or may not retreat, or may slightly retreat even. The cumulative excess return from offer announcement, okay, that's one measure we examine, okay? The cumulative excess return from offer announcement to offer rejection or after rejection may or may not exceed on average the offer premium. So we can compare the cumulative excess return from offer announcement to the offer premium. If the cumulative excess return exceeds the offer premium, then the decision to reject is definitely rational and can say it's right. Okay, so now we, Yevgeny, my dear friend, added a picture here of a small girl looking behind this curtain. So we'll start looking behind the curtain and all those numbers and see if we can find something. This is the slide that shows you how lax is the regulation in Israel regarding tender offers compared to the United States. Okay, those are freeze-out tender offers, okay? Yes, you have to reach 95% of outstanding shares to force the rest of the shareholders to bid their shares to you. But it's more than United States, but you don't need even a discussion board. No board discussion, no board opinion, no special committee, no fairness opinion. Appraisal rights depends. There are some appraisal rights, but we looked and we never found the case of appraisal of in the court. Maybe say behind the scenes. Okay, I don't know. But in the court, we didn't see any fights. Nothing. Disclosure about the company. Nothing. A 2-3-page document that I can wake up in the morning and say, why don't I draft something like that to shareholders? Maybe they'll bite. Okay. What our data set is... Andrew, are you keeping my time? Okay. We identify 274 transactions of freeze of tender offers and stocks. We exclude stocks with no trading volume because those stocks, what does the premium mean? We exclude non-cash deals. And if offer price is below all recent prices, we exclude also the firm. There are about 30 offers like that, and those are not typical freeze-out offers. Those are probably offers of firms that are collapsing, they need restructuring, and that you are even happy to be offered below market value just to get rid of the thing. Although for the control group, it's better to do the structuring when the firm is private. So we eliminate all those firms. We are left with 201 cases. And just to show you, we tried to collect going private mergers, but there were only 38 of them because this form of freeze-out tender offers is so simple. Everybody, it's a simple venue to go. Okay, about descriptive statistics, the firms are small. $192 million means about $192 million means about $50 million. Those are small companies, and the control group has about 82% of the shares, and the institutional investors have on average 4.3% of the shares. And the premium that they offer is about 20%. We have here also repeated offer, meaning second and third offers after the first one failed. About 15% of the sample are repeated offers, okay. And days from announcement to decision, about 23 calendar days. Acceptance rate, we have here a world record. Only about 50%. The numbers in the United States are close to 80%. I've seen a number from Norway, where is Ola, of 90% acceptance rate. Well, those are the typical numbers, thank you. But here we have 50%, about 50%. 132 offers in firms with institutional holdings, 69 without. It's non-representative of the task. We have no technology firms in the sample, no banks, almost no banks and financial institutions. Those are small firms controlled by controlling shareholders, and I don't know what their thoughts are exactly. Distribution you see of results of offer premiums, there was one firm with above 150. We do winsorizing. There are a few firms with below zero, meaning we still keep them because if you calculate relative today minus 42, it's still positive, so we are not sure those are bad offers. Here are offer rejection rates. So there was a a change in the regulation, not in the regulation, there was a change in the United States, some kind of Cox communication ruling that made tender offers more difficult. So offer premium, what we see about offer premium is first, interesting, successful and unsuccessful offers have about the same premium. You cannot judge offer just by its premium. Interesting. And the other thing that is more related to our work is that when institutional investors are present, and we are talking about successful offers, why are we talking about successful offers? Because these are offers where money changed hands, not numbers on the wall. Okay, these are offers when actual things happen. Okay, so if you look at that, you see that when the institutional investors are present, the offer premium paid is about 5% more. And if you do it, with a regression, and you introduce firm size, interesting, you see that premium is lower when the firm is higher. In our view, it is because of information asymmetry is higher for smaller firms. So they have to offer, those are successful offers, okay? So if you want to be successful, you have to offer higher premium. If you are smaller, because there are more information uncertainty, more disbelief, more premium you have to pay to succeed, to convince the public. Okay, but from our point of view, we see a 10% higher premium for when institutional investors are present, and other expected side, okay, signs, and at the average institutional investor holdings of 4.3% average in our sample, there is an increase of 11.7% in the premium, most of which is due to the mere presence of institutional investors. When you add the level of holdings of the institutional investor, it has a positive coefficient. It increases the premium, but insignificantly. It's enough that you have any presence by institutional investor and premium, according to our fitted analysis, okay, premium jumps 10%. So it's a jump the moment you have even one. And then with holdings, it increases, not impressively, but increases, okay? Now, offer acceptance rate. Here we have a probit analysis, okay? And what you see, firm size, okay, again, larger firms are more trustable and they are more successful in freeze-out offers because people are not that much disbelief, don't have that much disbelief in their motives. There is, of course, the expected coefficient of control minus holdings because control group holdings, because the higher the control group's holdings, the less distance they have to reach this 95% threshold that guarantees the success of the offer. So if they have less way to go, they are more successful. And if we look at institutional presence, again, it's negative, meaning lower chances of success when institutional investors are present. And if you wonder about the relation with the premium, it is positive but insignificant, okay? Like the lower group of premiums have a success rate of about 54, okay, percent, while the higher group of have only, more than that, about 60%, not impressive very much. So So let's go to what I call the Xbox rationality of the rejection decision. And here we see the cumulative of normal returns surrounding failed offers. And you see, even when you reject the offer, okay, maybe you see a little loss of 1 or 2%, but the jump of 20% due to the offer of premium stays with the firm, okay? So it's not that bad to reject the offer. If you do it correctly, you don't lose the offer premium. Or maybe you lose 1 or 2%, okay, on average. We use here the net of market model, and here are some numbers comparing institutional investors to no institutional investors. And what we see is first we see that the difference between CAR from announcement date to rejection date, okay? CAR, from announcement date to rejection rate is close to the offer premium, 1.5% on average less, and when no institutional investors are present, only 1% less. So one thing you say, we don't see any effect of having an institutional investor in the firm. And here we measure from announcement day to half a year after the offer rejection. And again, if you look at the averages, it's positive. Okay, maybe it means that after all, the decision was correct and company went up even more than the offer premium. If you look at the medians, it's okay, it's about zero, and no difference between institutional and no institutional investors. Our interpretation. Our first two findings are consisting with both competing hypotheses and biased rational response to each offer. This is the hypothesis two. Explain that institutional investors reject bad offers, extract higher premium, okay. The strategic decision. Explain the institutional investor play tough with controlling shareholders. Bad and even fair offers are rejected. Only general offer accepted. Okay. Okay, then I have to finish. Our third finding appears more consistent with hypothesis three. Explains that fair or even slightly beneficial offers rejected. That's why CAR might be slightly negative and not different between institutional and no institutional investors. There is potential criticism, but I'm glad that I don't have time to go over it. Well, the first time I present it, probably criticism can go from now, from here to summary, main findings, and maybe I'll put this as the last slide. Institutional investors do benefit other investors. Okay, they are important, they do benefit other investors, willingly or unwillingly, I don't care. Okay, overall, the evidence provides some support to the hypothesis that institutional investors are strategic players in a repeated game or conflict with controlling shareholders. Okay, I think so. And the puzzle or the question I want to raise now, should institutional investors be allowed to collude on corporate governance issues, okay? Because what we see that the level of institutional holdings have only slight effect. The main effect is having an institutional investor. Having more and more holdings by institutional investors, and perhaps more and more institutional investors, doesn't have that much of a positive effect. Perhaps because they are not allowed to collude. And here I put a smiley to black. Bernie, you see that smiley? Okay. He wrote in 1992, why don't you let institutional investors to collude? Okay. I don't know the answer. Okay. And more tests are usually, that's the comments. Welcome. Okay. Thank you.